you're like me, you're tired of the same old stories about the American Revolution.
I never had George ready. I want to hear from someone else, like...
Betsy Ross!
Betsy Ross!
Finally, the woman who sewed the first American stitch heard around the world.
And everybody, here she is. The seamstress of the Revolution.
The Empress of Embroidering.
The Sultan of Sandal Stitch.
The Guru of Needlework. Betsy Ross!
Tell us, Betsy, tell us. Shooby-dooby, shooby-doo, shoo. Come on, Betsy, tell us. Shooby-dooby, shooby-doo, shoo. Tell us, Betsy, help us win the war. Tell us, Betsy, tell us. Tell us before.
Tell us about the American Revolution again, Betsy.
Oh my, it's been so many years.
Please?
Okay. Well, a good place to start is when England defeated France and Spain in a long war.
My dad told me about that. The colonists helped the British defeat the French here in America in 1763.
Yes, but the French and Indian War was just a small part of a much bigger conflict, a patch of the quilt of the world politics. England was the leading power in the world. How King George III gloated.
Tremendous news, Your Majesty! We've won the 7 Years' War!
Well, it's about time. We've been fighting for, how many years now?
7.
That's quite a coincidence, isn't it?
Yes, my lord. Our victory is especially beneficial for our prospects in America.
America? How splendid! Do we get any of those fur hats? You can't be America for fur hats.
Even better, Your Majesty.
Better than fur hats? You don't mean fur sunglasses?
Your Majesty, we've driven the French out of most of America. The entire North is ours, as well as Florida and everything east of the Mississippi.
Our empire has never been bigger. We rule the seas. Our colonies are rich and well organized. England is the most powerful country in the world.
In other words...
That's right, Your Majesty.
You the man!
Who the man?
You the man!
Who the man?
You the man!
Rootin' tootin' right on the man!
We spank, don't spin. We flog the French. We whip the world. Yeah, we're a mensch. Our colonies are our great joy. Hey, and America, our favorite toy. And it's great to be an empire. Everyone shines your shoes. Yeah, it's great to be an empire. Nobody can refuse. It's great to be an empire in its early days and its early ways. It's great to be an empire, cause it pays.
to our knees. So where to turn? The colonies. They fought with us to win the war. Hey, and now they know what they fought for. And it's great to be an empire. Everyone shines your shoes. Yeah, it's great to be an empire. Nobody can refuse. It's great to be an empire in its early days and its early ways. It's great to be an empire, cause it pays. It's great to be an empire in its early days and its early ways. It's great to be an empire, cause it pays.
What did they mean it pays? Does being an empire come with a salary or retirement plans and stuff like that?
Even better, England was in debt for over 140 million pounds. King George and the Parliament decided the colonies could help pay for that.
140 million pounds? Wow, like you need to diet for a few months to lose that.
Pounds, as in money, as in English money, dear. The British Parliament passed a series of acts that placed duties and taxes on the colonists. By 1767, those colonists were unhappy.
Mr. Otis, what is the latest?
John Adams, I'm glad I ran into you. It's another British outrage. They've passed the Townsend Act, which put import duties on just about everything.
I didn't think this could get any worse. Roddy had the Hat Act, Wool Act, Iron Act, Currency Act, and Sugar Act.
I know it. The British just can't get their acts together.
Remember the Stamp Act?
A direct tax on everything we printed, from cards to calendars.
I loved what you said. What was it? Taxation without representation is exploitation?
Tyranny.
What?
I said tyranny. Taxation without representation is tyranny.
You did? Doesn't even rhyme, though, does it?
It's not supposed to rhyme. It's an aphorism.
Well, of course, but the good ones rhyme. Take Ben Franklin Maxims. He that goes a-borrowing goes a-sorrowing. Little strokes fell great oaks, plow deep while sluggards sleep.
Okay, I get it. The point is, the British are not treating us as equals, but as subjects. They prohibit us from settling among the Appalachians. They've even started enforcing our navigation laws, so all commerce between England here must be by British vessels.
You're right, this has got to stop.
Taxing my glass and everything I see. They call them levies. They feel like a tax to me. They're taxing my sugar. They're taxing my paint. I don't think there's nothing I got that they ain't. They're taxing my tax and adding on a fee. They call it duties. They feel like a tax to me. Taxation, taxation, without representation. It's not right time to fight. La 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 la. Taxation, taxation, without representation. It's not right time to fight. La 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 la. The Hat Act, the Wool Act, the Iron Act too. The Townsend Act, Greenville Act, what should we do? And what else is left? They wouldn't touch my tea. They call them acts, but they feel like a tax to me.
Taxation, taxation, without representation. It's not right time to fight. This is the last straw, my fellow Bostonians!
You tell them, Sam!
Did we fight the Townsend Acts? We refused to import English goods and pay the duties. And did we relent?
Never!
What about the Boston Massacre?
Right, the British shot and killed 3 unarmed colonists.
And did we give up?
Never!
What if, and finally, we had to repel the Townsend Acts in 1770.
Why?
And here we are, 3 years later. They passed the Tea Act, and are we going to keep paying a tax on tea?
Never!
They've shipped 500,000 pounds of tea into the harbor. Are we going to buy it? Well, are we?
Come on, Miss Daddins, we've got to have a spill of tea.
Yeah, I mean, we're only human.
And the prices are so low.
Yeah.
Listen to me. Today it's tea. Tomorrow it's sugar. The next day it's those nice fuzzy slippers that keep our feet so warm in the winter.
No, slippers!
Yes, your slippers. It's time we... When do we stop letting the British kick us around? It's time for action.
Right!
It's time we stop calling soccer football.
Right!
It's time we started driving on the right-hand side of the road.
Right!
It's time we dressed up as our natives and dumped those 342 chests of tea into the harbor.
Right!
Dump it off the boat. Down, down, down. Let's see if it can float. Down, down, down. It's sinking in the sea. Something's brewing, boys, and it ain't tea. Something's brewing, boys, and it ain't tea. Trouble's brewing for the crown. Tell them all in London town, London town. All their lovely tea just drowned. Send some more, it's going down. Send some more, it's going down. Send some more, it's going down. Down, 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 just dump it off the boat. Down, 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 let's see if it can float. Down, 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 it's sinking in the sea. Something's brewing, boys, and it ain't tea. Something's brewing, boys, and it ain't tea. Something's brewing, boys, and it ain't tea.
I can't believe the colonists destroyed all that tea.
Yes, in Maryland, they burned the ship, all the tea, and all of its cargo.
King George must have been mad.
Yes, the English were really getting their threads in a tangle. They closed Boston Harbor, put restrictions on town meetings, and moved trials with officials that killed colonists from America to England.
Betsy! Betsy Ross! I'm so glad you're home!
John Jay, you look like you're about to burst a stitch.
I've been trying to knit a sweater for my dachshund, and something has gone terribly wrong.
Oh my, let me see.
But Betsy, what did we do after the British shut down Boston Harbor?
Why, we called the First Continental Congress, of course.
Were you there, Mr. Jay?
Sure was. 55 men gathered, including John and Sam Adams, George Washington, and Patrick Henry.
I know not, of course, others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death.
Wow, was that Patrick Henry?
Yes, but don't encourage him, children, or just keep doing it.
Did all the colonists want independence?
Well, at that point, most of us just wanted the legislation repealed. We called for a complete boycott of British goods, but when our petitions were rejected, we began to collect muskets.
And that's when the British decided to send troops from Boston to seize weapons and arrest colonist leaders, right?
And thus the famous ride of Paul Revere.
Paul Revere, sweet boy, I think I once turned a horse for you.
The redcoats are coming! The redcoats are coming!
Calm down, Paul. It's nearly midnight. You'll wake the kids.
We're awake! The redcoats are coming!
Sit down, children. Your father's a bit nervous.
Of course I'm nervous. The British are coming out of Boston to arrest our colonial leaders, take our weapons and supplies.
Are they coming by land or by sea?
I don't remember. I think it's two lanterns. If by land, one if by sea. Or maybe it's even one if by land and two if by sea. I think three means they're coming by blimp.
Take it easy. You have to go warn the people of Lexington and Concord.
Yes, I must go at once.
John Hancock, alert Sam Adams too. The British will arrest them, their fate is up to you.
Hurry, Paul, dear, hurry, do not stop to chat. Paul, what are you doing?
I forgot my hat.
Ride on, Paul Revere. Ride on, Paul Revere. Get on out of here, dear Paul Revere. Lexington is waiting. They must hear the news. The British are advancing. Now there's no time to lose.
Tell the Minuteman there, they must take a stance. Paul, what are you doing?
I forgot my pants.
Ride on, Paul Revere. Ride on, Paul Revere. Get on out of here, dear Paul Revere.
The Second Continental Congress is now in session in Independence Hall, Philadelphia. The Honorable John Hancock presiding.
Thomas, Tom Jefferson, where's John Hancock?
Oh, hello, Ben. Well, I sent him out to get some coffee cake.
Coffee cake?
Of course. What's a Continental Congress without a Continental breakfast?
I heartily agree, Tom, but we already have a selection of coffee, juices, and those delicious individually wrapped danishes.
True. But I thought John needed something to do this morning. He's been acting a bit strange since we voted to endorse the Declaration of Independence this morning.
A brilliant document, Tom. And now we must all hang together, or assuredly we shall all hang separately.
It's been over a year since the first shots were fired between us and the British. Just a month later, we elected George Washington to head the Continental Army. We've been unofficially at war ever since.
King George has rejected our efforts at reconciliation.
Tom Paine put it nicely when he wrote that, "These are the times that try men's souls."
Yes, that was well put. It doesn't rhyme though, does it?
What?
I think my own maxims always stick a bit better with a cute rhyme. Vessels large may venture more, but little boats should keep near shore. See how it flows?
Sure, Ben, but I don't think...
Or remember this,
Here Skug lies snug as a bug in a rug.
What exactly does that mean?
That's not the point. I've got 4 rhyming words there out of 10. That's a 40% rhyme rate. You won't find that in any of the British poets. Check out Shakespeare or Pope. They've got a 10, maybe 15% rhyme rate max.
That's great, Ben.
Great? It's crucial. The British may have better trained soldiers, they may have more money, experience, and weapons, but America has the rhymes. Victory will be ours!
Oh, look out! Here comes John Hancock!
Where is it?
What are you looking for?
The Declaration of Independence!
It's quite exciting, isn't it?
You bet, but where is it?
Here in Tom's head. He wrote it. Tom, recite that bit about the self-evident truths again.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Yeah, that's great and all, but where's the parchment itself? I'm ready.
Ready for what?
Ready to sign it, of course.
John, I told you this morning, the final document won't be ready to sign for a month or so.
But I'm ready now, I've been practicing. Don't have Franklin's eloquence. I don't have Tom Paine's common sense. But man, my signature's intense. Tom, where do I sign? George Washington and all his staff may fight real hard on our behalf. But you should see my autograph. Tom, where do I sign? Ooh, where do I sign? Where do I sign? Ooh, where do I sign? Where do I sign? Where do I sign?
He's practicing on all the walls, on tablecloths and bathroom stalls. Good thing we don't yet have baseballs.
Tom, where do I sign?
Signing stuff around the clock. He signed my head.
He signed my sock.
Sock, chin, hop. Tom, where I sign?
Ooh, where do I sign? Where do I sign?
Did the colonists really think they could defeat the British Empire?
Well, we definitely had some disadvantages.
I'll say. There was no real unity. The colonists distrusted each other.
There was no central authority to raise money through taxes.
The army was hard to organize and nearly impossible to keep together.
And don't forget, probably no more than 1/3 of the colonists even wanted independence all that much. And
yes.
And there were hundreds of thousands who remained loyal to England.
And the British were 3,000 miles away from home and had a huge area to try and control.
And they had second-rate generals.
While the colonists had George Washington, who turned out to be a fantastic leader. And don't forget the French. They were always ready to help anyone who might hurt England.
But you're forgetting one of the biggest advantages.
I was wondering when you'd remember.
What?
My flag, of course. I tried to talk them into a red, white, and blue lounge chair with a matching ottoman, but they said their budget was only cut for a flag.
Oh, your flag was wonderful, but I was thinking of how the colonists fought dirty.
I beg your pardon?
Oh, I didn't mean it that way. I mean, they were literally dirty. They blended in with the scenery.
I tell you, it ain't right. They should stand up and fight like we do.
Yeah, instead of sneaking around with those fur caps and deerskin coats all quiet like, you can't even see them. It ain't fair!
I mean, look at us, all polished up bright and red. They can see us coming miles away. That's the proper way to fight.
Exactly. We stand up straight and wait our turn to shoot and be shot at. It's gentlemanly. None of us skulking around.
Well, I'm onto them. You won't find one of them men sneaking up on me. No siree.
Good evening, folks! Welcome again to America's Home Shopping History Channel. Alice, what do you have for a shop us tonight?
Bert, tonight we've got memorabilia from the American Revolutionary War.
Excellent! So, let's get right to it. We've got over 6 years of fighting in every single colony and more than a dozen important battles.
Our first item, number J57, is a boot from John Burgoyne, the British general who lost the Battle of Saratoga.
His boot? Wow, I'm guessing we don't have many of those left.
Just two. They come from the famous battle in 1777 that gave the colonists a badly needed boost.
Smell that, Alice?
What?
Go on, take a whiff. Do you know what that smells like, Alice?
A really, really old boot?
No, it smells like victory! And you too can grab victory from defeat by throwing us right now to purchase your own General Burgoyne shoe. Victory from defeat? Defeat? Get it? Well, what's that lovely item over there, Alice?
This is B-65, a snowball from Valley Forge in Pennsylvania, where George Washington and his army were forced to spend a devastating winter.
These things are going fast, folks!
We sold out in just 15 minutes the last time we offered this at this unbelievable try-me price.
Just one per customer, please.
We have just a few minutes before our stock completely melts underneath these studio lights.
And we got a satisfied customer on the phone right now. Hello, who are you? What do you do? And tell us just how much you love your snowball.
Hello, am I on the air?
You sure are!
My name is Comte de Rochambeau. I am from France.
How wonderful! General Rochambeau arrived from France in 1780 with over 6,000 troops to aid the colonists. French help was decisive in winning the war.
Rochambeau, you said. Didn't you invent the chocolate éclair?
No! I was commander of the French troops at Yorktown alongside George Washington and his men. I thought your viewers should know!
Terrific! So, how do you like your snowball? You probably serve some fancy fun sauce, am I right?
I have no idea what you're talking about! I am a general, not a chef!
Ah, those French cooks, so modest!
Our next diamond is being brought to us right now by John Paul Jones.
Hi, Alice. I helped the American Navy get its sea legs and even defeated a number of British ships off the coast of England.
So, what you got there?
This is a button from the coat that British General Cornwallis was wearing when he surrendered to George Washington and our French allies at Yorktown in 1781. It's a lovely brass finish and oven safe.
Amazing! Hold it up so our viewers can get a good look at it.
Benedict Arnold, get back here, you traitor. I've not yet begun the fight.
And tell it to us, too. Good night.
And stay tuned. Next on the American History Channel, we have our new documentary on Grover Cleveland, Man, Myth, City, or Sesame Street Puppet.
So what happened after the British surrendered, Mr. J?
I went to help Ben Franklin and John Adams work out the Treaty of Paris in 1783. The British conceded all the land from the Mississippi River to the Atlantic Ocean, from Spanish Florida to the Great Lakes.
That was great!
Well, it was complicated. The Articles of Confederation, which had been the basis for the central government, intentionally gave little power to Congress.
Couldn't they do anything?
Not much. We did pass the Northwest Ordinance, which provided the eventual incorporation of new states from the land between the Mississippi and Ohio rivers.
And I macrame-made the Liberty Bell.
Well, now, Betsy, you've got to stop exaggerating.
I dropped a stitch on the seam, didn't I? And I see a little crack opened up. I think a few pleats would have helped.
Betsy, you know that isn't...
Shush, dear. Let's listen to the colonists.
What more could we ask for? We've got 13 independent states and a loose confederation. There's no executive power in the central government. We don't need another king around here.
But Congress has no power to control commerce or enforce its tax collection program.
Exactly. It's all up to the individual states.
I don't know. Are you sure this is a good thing?
What could go wrong?
Thirteen little countries. How great. 13 little countries. Can't wait.
There's no more king of England.
Just throwing round his weight. 13 little countries.
Brand new.
13 little countries. What to do. 13 foreign policies, 13 kinds of laws, 13 sets of boundary lines that kind of gives you a pause, 13 little armies, 13 ways to fight, 13 major headaches, now with no relief in sight. 13 little countries.
Hear ye, hear ye, on this day, July 16th, 1787, the Constitutional Convention is now in session in Philadelphia, the Honorable George Washington presiding. Good afternoon, Mr. Madison.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Mr. Hamilton.
Oh yes, good afternoon. James, we have important decisions to make.
Yes, we do, Alexander. Look out! It's Aaron Burr!
Ah!
I was just joking. I love doing that.
That's not funny.
Alexander, lighten up a little. We're making good progress. We've agreed to have three branches of government, the executive, the legislative, and judicial, that will balance and check each other.
Yes, a wonderful plan, but there are even more important matters. I need your advice.
What's on your mind, Alexander?
You know I favor a strong central bank, and now I'm faced with a huge decision.
What is it?
Which do you think is more impressive, my left profile or my right?
What?
When we start printing money, I'm just dying to get my picture on one of the bills. George Washington's already claimed the $1 bill, so I'm shooting for the 10. Personally, I think my left side makes me look taller. What do you think?
That's not what I meant by lightening up, Alexander. We have real issues here. The big states and small states still can't agree on how they should be represented in Congress.
We big states have more people. We are not going to share equally with you little states.
Yeah, well, we're not going to settle for proportionate representation in both houses of Congress. We're just as important as you.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah! Lots of votes. Big states rule. We need lots of votes. Big states rule. We deserve the best. The little states can scramble for the rest. Little states can scramble for the rest. Georgia really needs to grow. Virginia's just a lump of snow. On Delaware, I stub my toe. On Delaware, I stub my toe. On Delaware.
Small states rule. We deserve our share. Small states rule. We deserve our share. Small states rule. We should be preferred. Big states sound a lot like George the Third. Big states sound a lot like George the Third. Pennsylvania's grown too fat. Virginia's an aristocrat. Aristocrat. Massachusetts ain't so nice. New York, New York. I hate it twice. New York, New York. I hate it twice. York, I hate it twice.
Big states rule, we deserve the best. Small states rule, we deserve our share. Small states rule, we deserve the best. The Constitution has to pass the test. The Constitution has to pass the test.
Big states, small states,
small states.
So that's why we now have one legislative body, the House, that has the proportional representation. Bigger states have more congresspeople.
And the other House, the Senate, gives the same number of representatives to every state, no matter how many people live there.
That's right. Like so much else in our Constitution, it was a compromise.
Like deciding to count a slave as three-fifths of a person.
We weren't perfect, Betsy, but we did stop the slave trade 20 years later.
Right, dear, although it was a beautifully stitched document.
Did anyone like the Constitution?
Oh no, some people thought it gave the central government too much power. Others thought the states had too much authority. I wrote some of the Federalist Papers to help convince people to vote for it.
Did it work?
Well, it took a while. We had to promise a Bill of Rights would be added. The Constitution was adopted June 21st, 1788.
Wow, the first election must have been something.
It was. The members of the House of Representatives were elected directly by citizens in each state. The senators were elected by the legislators of each state, and George Washington was unanimously selected as presidency by the Electoral College.
How does that work?
No one knows, dear. It's a complete mystery.
Please, Betsy, it's just a bit complicated.
Well, then why don't we ask these fellows here, since they're on their way to participate in the first Electoral College?
So how exactly does this work?
Don't know.
Oh, read the first sentence about... Wait. Shoot.
Go
away. Read the first sentence.
We the people of the United States, in order to form a perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our prosperity, to ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America.
I said just the first sentence.
That was the first sentence.
Wow. Find the part about the Electoral College.
Here it is in Article 2. The electors shall meet in their respective states and vote by ballot for two persons, of whom one shall not be an inhabitant of the same state with themselves.
Not be an inhabitant of the same state with themselves? How does that work?
Don't know. Here, maybe this will help. But in choosing the president, the vote shall be taken by states, the representation from each state having one vote, a quorum. For this purpose shall consist of a member or members from 2/3 of the states, and the majority of all the states shall be necessary to a choice.
What does that mean?
Don't know. But what the heck? We got a vote!
I said from the start, I'm not all that smart. And I don't have political knowledge. I guess there's no need, 'cause though I can't read, I'm off to Electoral College. Whoa! Vote, vote, vote! Whoa, that is my intent. Gonna vote, for president. Gonna vote for president. Vote, vote, don't have a clue about Article 2. Whoa, that's why I've been sent. Gonna vote, gonna vote for president. Gonna vote for president. I really doubt I'll figure this out, but all the founders are clever. They'll rearrange, soon it'll change. We can't keep this system forever. Whoa, vote, vote, vote. Whoa, that's why I've been sent. Gonna vote, gonna vote, gonna vote for president. Gonna vote for president. Gonna vote, gonna vote, gonna vote, gonna vote.
On April 30th, 1789, George Washington was sworn in as president as in the contemporary capital of New York.
Wow, what a great story.
As my friend Ben Franklin said at the time, our Constitution is an actual operation. Everything appears to be promising but that it will last. But in this world, nothing is certain except death and taxes.
I have a Franklin stove. You know, it doesn't look a bit like him. Ah, here you go, John. This should work.
It's perfect. I've got to show Lafayette.
The French general who fought for the colonists?
No, my Dashin.
Betsy, could you tell us the story again?
We just finished, dear.
Please!
Okay, well, John is a good person, but he did leave out a few details about how I wove a ship for the Navy out of pine needles, where I always sewed together the pants of the British Army so they couldn't run up Bunker Hill, or the time.
Tell us, Betsy, tell us, shooby-dooby, shooby-doo-shoo. Come on, Betsy, tell us, shooby-dooby, shooby-doo-shoo. Tell us how your sewing helped us win the war. Tell us, Betsy, tell us, the tales of youth before. Tell us, Betsy, tell us. Forge. Tell us, Betsy, tell us, the time that you say shooby-dooby, shooby-doo-shoo, shooby-dooby, shooby-doo-shoo.
Tell us, Betsy, tell us, shooby-dooby, shooby-doo-shoo. Come on, Betsy, tell us, shooby-dooby, shooby-doo-shoo. Tell us how your sewing helped us win the war. Tell us, Betsy, tell us, the tales you've told before. Tell us, Betsy, tell us, shooby-dooby.